classes of people that she says still have freedom in our society are the artists and scientists, in that scientists can create new life forms, new things. Richard Feynman and other people have written a lot about this. Freeman Dyson has said that scientists will become the poets of the 21st century. And what he means by this is that scientists will be creating new art, but what he means by that is new lives, new life forms. And that will be what art comes. Art and science will merge in that instead of creating poems, will create new life forms. And it's Freeman Dyson, who's one of the leading physicists in this country. I will leave you with that, but I want to read the footnote 87 on page 323, the last footnote of the book. I usually read lots of footnotes in hers, but the footnotes are great. But I at least wanted to leave you with this and make sure you don't overlook it. This inherent worldliness of the artist, namely that the artist creates things that persevere in the world that are eternal, not eternal, immortal, I apologize. The inherent worldliness of the artist is, of course, not changed if non-objective art replaces the representation of things. So Arendt actually collected abstract art. She was a big fan of abstract art. To mistake this non-objectivity for subjectivity, where the artist feels called upon to express himself, his subjective feeling is the mark of charlatans, not artists. The artist, whether painter or sculptor or poet or musician, produces worldly objects, and his reification has nothing in common with the highly questionable and, at any rate, wholly unartistic practice of expression. Expressionist art, but not abstract art, is a contradiction in terms. So I'll leave you with that.
Cathedral, or we can create
United States of America. We can create things that last and that people think deserve to last. And that's where our freedom lies. So she sees freedom as the freedom to act in concert with others, to do things that are unique, different, and display what is meaningful about ourselves. Now, some people act and do stuff and they try and kill all the Jews, or they try and, you know, kill all whatever people you want to kill. As she rightly says, those people can be great actors, but we don't like them, right? We don't like what they're doing, and we can judge it as bad, moral. But she does think that what makes us, that the highest thing that makes us human is our ability to act with people who are different from ourselves in a pluralistic world in such a way that without denying our differences, we come to see together that certain things hold us together in common and deserve to. That's what Immanuel Kant says aesthetic judgment is. It's a judgment with no rules of a universal without being set down from above, but from comes up from the fact that everyone knows that this is beautiful. And Arendt argues that freedom is the freedom to act, and thus also to be judged by others as whether your action is beautiful or not. I don't know if that's answered your question, but and I'm happy to have people push on it. The human condition stuff, I mean, it's, you know, in the introduction, she talks about why she calls it the human condition as opposed to human nature. I mean, by the way, the original title for this book was not The Human Condition, it was The Vita Activa. The English publisher didn't think people would buy that, so they changed it to The Human Condition. But she talks about what the human condition is. In her view, she says the conditions of human existence can never explain who we are. They're not nature, but they are what conditions us. And most of the things that condition us are things we've created. And we live in a world, and that world is ever changing, and yet also durable. And the human condition, as it's evolved, emerges in relation to all those things we've done, said, experienced, also nature, that condition us. And so I don't know why, I'm not sure we have an issue with that. So.
Behaviorists in the 50s, but
that's not what she means by it. I mean, when she talks about behaviorism, she's talking about something else. She thinks that she's very worried about behavior, but she thinks it goes much deeper than behaviorism. Behaviorism is not rooted in the psychology of the 1950s. It's rooted in Galileo's telescope and the conviction that our senses are unreliable, that human beings are thus unreliable, and the only thing that's reliable is instruments that can measure universal truths. That's the fundamental change that makes behavioralism possible 300 years later. Right, that's what this book is doing, is showing the intellectual history of this dangerous thing called behavioralism in the rise of modern science, and showing how this rise of modern science and behavioralism threatens the human condition of labor, work, and action as it has emerged since the beginning of humanity. Yeah.
What does she make of given this kind of quite singular approach to science, and what you're describing as science having is kind of binding the place of truth to itself? What does she make of Heisenberg and Einstein in relation to the shifted new ground that shifts with their understanding of their, you know, scientific understanding of the world as being essentially one having innately a place of doubt and secondly innately a place of relativity?
So two things in response to that. One is, I don't think it's such an eclectic version of science. I mean, and this is my history, for those of you who don't know, is as a historian of science. I wasn't an RN scholar before I came to Bard. But this view of science that she's presenting has a long history. It begins slightly different places, but Hegel tells the story. Nietzsche certainly tells the story. Heidegger is a huge proponent of the story. Heidegger was her teacher, and of course her lover for a certain amount of time, a year, two, couple years. And a man named Alfred North Whitehead in the Anglo-American tradition, whose work is very important in this, is a similar critique, critic of science. Weber, in certain of his books, is making these arguments. So this is, I'm just trying to say, this is a widely this is a fairly widely offered critique. My first book, called The Gift of Science, was actually about the history of science, and it doesn't mention Arendt. I mean, I was not an Arendt scholar before. The second question of what she does with scientists like Heisenberg and others is fascinating. I mean, there's many citations to some of these scientists in these chapters 36 to 40, really. There's also, if you're interested, again in this book, Between Fast and Future, if you haven't noticed, I love this book, there's an essay at the end of it, not in the first edition, but in later editions, called The Conquest of Space. And in it, she talks much more explicitly in relation to Heisenberg and Schrodinger and others. And the basic argument is that people like Heisenberg and Schrodinger really did understand this. And therefore, they offered a science that was a little more humble and that was not going to provide answers. So maybe this is one thing we should say. We're not actually talking about great scientists when we talk about modern science in the way she's talking about it. We're talking about people who, first of all, in general, we're talking about social scientists who try and apply natural science to humans. She has much less trouble with Heisenberg and Einstein and biologists, depends on being biology, but zoologists. There's a confusion between biologists and zoologists, because biologists apparently study eos, which is human life, and think that they can reduce that to natural science, which is what they really mean is zoologists. The point is, her real beef is with social science. People who want to take the certainty of natural science and translate it onto humanity, which from her point of view is free and inscrutable and unpredictable. And that to do so is to commit what she calls genocide. Genocide. It's the dream of social science is to destroy humanity. My words, not hers, but I think it's fair. You know, she's very interested in Heisenberg's philosophical work on uncertainty. I'm not sure if I'm answering your question, but I'm not.
No, I was actually, you are answering the question, and my follow-up question is, if when you were talking, and I was thinking about the work that you're actually now, wondering whether her anxiety about this place of inevitable laws, actually. We would apply now
about political science, right? Which has very little to do with technology. I mean, we use math in political science. Or economics, not a whole lot of technology in economics. But the premise of economics and political science is that there are theories that, you know, man is a profit maximizing, a happiness maximizing, unhappiness minimizing animal, maximizing, right? Utilitarianism, or some other theory. And this is, you can call this technique, and in Heidegger's sense, this is what he means by techne in some sense, so we can. But I think it's less to do with technology and more to do with a way of thinking that sees all beings as countable and knowable. That is techne in the Greek sense, not technology, which is why it's actually a mistranslation of Heidegger's essay on concerning technology. That's not what he wrote. There's a good word, technologie in German. It's technique. It's an essay concerning the technical, or technical thinking, which is the thinking in which you think you can know things and figure them out and solve them. The sections, we didn't read it, but the sections in the private and public chapter on the law of large numbers is a fascinating, I think it's on page. Anyway, you should pay attention. What she basically says is the law of large numbers, which says that with statistics, we can, in a sense, predict who will buy what, right? This is how Amazon and, you know, big data, right? We've gotten even past what she thought is the large big numbers, the big data, is the end of human freedom. Another way of thinking about it, because not only will we be sold what we want or what they want us to buy and stuff like that, but to the extent there are people who are outliers, we call them artists or crazy people, right? To the extent there are people who are outliers, we say they're not outliers, they are predicted in the law of large numbers that there will always be a bell curve with some outliers on it. And so even the outliers now become part of the system. And they can't therefore dent the system, because when they're there, they're not surprising, they're expected. So we now expect the outliers and therefore don't pay attention to them, because we consider them just part of the system. So that's the sections on the law of large numbers in the private public chapter are really worth paying attention to. Do you guys want to? I don't know who I should push. You know, I don't know if there's a. I just. Okay. Yes. I'm just going to random.
What was her feelings about the. You talk about social science, and I don't think psychology necessarily is social science in the same way. But how did she feel about Freud? He's not mentioned at all, but also he seems to be a guy who periodically acknowledges the limits of his own thing, which I think would appeal to her.
Okay, so she does not write about Freud very much. She's not a fan of psychoanalysis. She doesn't know much about him. One of her best students, and who ended up being her biographer, and written some great books about her, Elizabeth Young Gould, who unfortunately died 2 years ago, became a psychoanalyst, and has written a lot about Arendt and psychoanalysis, and tried to argue that Arendt's hatred of psychoanalysis was misplaced, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not gonna go into all that. The reason she didn't like psychoanalysis is that it sought hidden meanings and hidden causes for human behavior, right? Hannah Arendt believed in appearances. She believed in that the appearances matter. She has whole chapters in the book Life of the Mind and other places on, and here in this book, on the space of appearance. Seeking hidden causes deprives us of freedom and our humanity. And so she was a skeptic about psychoanalysis. She doesn't, whether she thought Freud was that or not, she never says. She doesn't write much about it. I assume she wasn't that interested in it. I also think, you know, here's a woman whose father died when she was 4 or 5 and who had survived the Holocaust, was in a camp. I just think she was uninterested, I mean, to be very honest.
Yeah. We're told in the introduction that Arndt fathered this book as a kind of prolegomena to a more systematic political theory. And the indication is that some of that was done, but it was never finished. What is that?
Actually, never read the introduction. Oh. I haven't read the introduction. I mean, Martin Canavan's a good scholar. I had to look to see if he did. I didn't know. She's a good scholar. I don't think Hannah Arendt ever had or intended to have a systematic philosophy. She's a thinker. She's suspicious of all philosophy. She doesn't call herself a philosopher. Now, we might call herself a philosopher, but it's fine. But she was suspicious of anyone who had a theory about anything. Honestly, I mean, she has whole essays on how we should be afraid and suspicious of anyone who says they have a theory of this or a theory of that. She just doesn't believe in theory. It's very funny. I'm giving this lecture to the MFA program, right, at Bard today at 5 o'clock. At 1 o'clock, I was in another building giving a lecture to 15 people sent here by the U.S. State Department to talk about international relations. So I was talking about international relations in Hannah Arendt. There's very few people who are so broad and interesting in their depth that can be interested in international relations and this. But I was talking about an essay of her called On Violence, in which she has a line in which she says, there is no greater danger to modern government and democracy than the entrance of intellectuals into politics. And what she means is, and intellectuals come into politics with theories. And she's writing about the Vietnam War. And when the facts don't back up their theories, they change the facts instead of giving up their theories. And she is always suspicious of intellectuals and always suspicious of theoreticians. And so the idea that she would ever have a systematic philosophy is, to me, doesn't make any sense. But I don't know what she was saying for the madness. I don't want to say, she may have meant something else by it. She was going to write a second book on what is politics. And there are drafts of part of it, and part of it has been published by Jerry Cohn, one of our other research assistants, is a book called The Promise of Politics. It has an essay in it called What is Politics? That was the way the beginning of this other work. But I don't think of it as a systematic work. I don't think this is a systematic book. I think that it's thoughtful and it's largely consistent, but that doesn't mean it's systematic. Yes?
I mean, I think you could say that the model thinker intellectual she is pointing to is more than in opposition to a Heidegger. Because she faced the incredible, horrible tragedy of the thinkers, of the greatest philosophers of the century, failing in the face of the Holocaust, and single-handedly try to save Walter Benjamin from oblivion, and was the first to translate him, get everything over. And he represents, I think, the kind of intellectual who's not attached to power, who can't get a job, who can barely be published. That's, in a sense,
So Hannah Arendt was deeply loved Walter Benjamin. They played chess regularly in Paris when they were both in exile. You're right. She, with Gershom Scholem, basically saved him from oblivion when Adorno and others wanted to let him go because they didn't think he fit the Marxist model. She didn't translate him, but she did arrange for him to be translated and introduced and wrote the introduction to Illuminations, which first made him known, at least in this country. She has a great essay called The Pearl Diver in her book Men in Dark Times on the Walter Benjamin. So a lot of what you say I would agree with. I wouldn't go as far as you would. I don't think he's her model of a thinker. I think Hannah Arendt has one model of a thinker, and that's Hannah Arendt. No, let me say there's two others. There's Socrates, and there's Karl Jaspers. Those are the two people she holds up explicitly and repeatedly through her work as a model of thinkers. You know, Benjamin was fascinating, and he was great in many ways, but he was
she
so.
She doesn't hold herself ever up as a model. Right?
No, no, she holds up Socrates and Jaspers. I mean, I think if you want to know what she thinks a model thinker is, you look at her. I mean, I'm holding her up as that. I think she calls herself a conscious pariah, right? Someone who consciously stands outside of society, has no interest in society, never took a full-time job, wanted to be as free as she could from all social obligations and commitments and economic obligations and commitments. Only then, she says, can you be free to look at the world and write about it. What she probably, I think Benjamin for her was not engaged enough politically, not engaged enough with the world, too much outside of it. But regardless, he meant a lot to her. He certainly is one of the many people she read closely and carefully. But Socrates is really the person that she holds up over and over again as her model for thinking. The essence of Socratic thinking is, there are two of them. One is that it is better to suffer wrong than to do wrong. And the other is that I would rather be out of tune with the whole of society than be out of tune with myself. That's not a direct quote, but basically the idea that it's more important to be true to yourself as a thinker and as someone with your own conscience and your own sense of what is right than to that to conform with everyone else. Yes, in the back.
What are wholly unartistic practices of expression?
Can you speak?
What are wholly unartistic practices of expression, and why is expressionist art a contribution?
Okay. Why is expressionist art a contradiction? I mean, I figured someone might ask about that. Because art is about creating things that are worldly and that deserve to be immortalized. And artists and art should therefore strive to create things that are universal. If you think that art is simply about expressing your own thoughts, your own feelings, you're not creating or not trying to create or creating something that is worldly. And so it's a misunderstanding of what art is. Is that? I mean, look, there can be people who are expressionist artists who are artists in her mind, insofar as their expression finds resonance universally. But what she's saying is that art is not just about feelings, it's about trying to tap it. She says art is thinking reified. It's not feeling. It's about thinking what is true and then finding extraordinary, memorable ways to make those ideas stand out in the world. That's how she understands art. It's not just her. I mean, this is a traditional way of thinking about art that many of her generation and many philosophers have held. Obviously, it's one that's in retreat today. Doesn't mean it's wrong, and it doesn't mean it's right. there's, you can certainly argue that artists today do something different, which is undoubtedly the case. And you can defend what they do, and you can call it art. All she would say is, that's not what art means in its traditional sense, or in the sense that she understands it as a worldly endeavor to create things that deserve to be immortalized.